In this module, we're going to talk about the equilibrium condition and what's called equilibrium constant, different than the rate constant like we saw in the kinetics chapter. So what's equilibrium? So in a chemical reaction, it can occur most of the time in the forward and the reverse directions. And we show this with these double arrows, meaning that it can occur forwards and in the reverse. In this particular reaction, it's the decomposition of dinitrogen tetroxide into two molecules of nitrogen dioxide. We could write it the other way. In other words, when you take two molecules of nitrogen dioxide, it's possible there for them to combine and form a molecule of dinitrogen tetroxide. Now, if we look at this graph here, concentration versus time, if we start with all dinitrogen tetroxide and no nitrogen dioxide, that's this curve right here, so zero concentration for nitrogen dioxide and some non-zero concentration for dinitrogen tetroxide, and then we let it react or decompose. What happens is the concentration of dinitrogen tetroxide starts decreasing as the concentration of nitrogen dioxide starts increasing. But notice they level off, right? Okay, what we mean by equilibrium is where the rate of this forward reaction is equal to the rate of the reverse reaction. When that's true, then the concentrations of the species present stay the same. The equilibrium concentrations don't change. However, this is a dynamic equilibrium. What that means is that those molecules within this mixture are going back and forth all the time. In other words, there's always dinitrogen tetroxide molecules breaking apart and making nitrogen dioxide. And there's all these nitrogen dioxide molecules coming together to make dinitrogen tetroxide. But at equilibrium, the rate at which the nitrogen dioxide is formed is the same as the rate at which the dinitrogen tetroxide is formed. And so the concentration of each stays the same. These lines are flat. Now, why does the rate change as this happens? Well, initially in this setup, there's only dinitrogen tetroxide, and so as it starts decomposing, it happens at some rate, the slope of this curve basically. But as these molecules are used up, there's fewer of them around, there's less likelihood, there's less probability, a little bit anyway at first, that there's going to be one that has the right energy to dissociate. At the same time, once we start making some of these guys start going back and making some of these again, and so that not the concentration of the dinitrogen tetroxide doesn't change as fast as this reaction proceeds. And same thing with the nitrogen dioxide. At first, its concentration is increasing rapidly because there wasn't any to begin with, and we're just making it. But as we start to make it, and now some of them start to come together and go back, and there's fewer of these breaking apart. The law of mass action says that for any equilibrium reaction, which we're going to write our generic equilibrium reaction as AA plus BB in equilibrium with CC and DD. In this notation, the lowercase letters are the coefficients in the balanced equation, the stoichiometric coefficients, and the capital letters, well, they're just they represent the formulas for the reactants or the products. So the law of max action says that if we take the ratio of the concentration of the products, each raised to the power of their coefficient, so the concentration of C to the C times the concentration of D to the power D, divided by the concentrations of the reactants raised to the powers of their coefficients, A to the A, B to the B, it's equal to some constant, K, which we call the equilibrium constant. Equilibrium constant, these are concentrations, molarities. The equilibrium constant depends upon temperature. So it's going to have a different value for different temperatures. But at any given temperature, no matter what concentrations you start with, you're always going to, when you plug them into this formula, they always equal, within experimental error, the same value, that equilibrium constant, which you can look up a lot of times. The other thing about the equilibrium constant, K, is that we do not use units for it. There's a reason we don't need to worry about that. We're just going to write it as dimensionless and everything works out. Sometimes you'll see the K equilibrium constant expression, oops, written like this, with a C down here to stand for concentrations. Because we'll see in the next module, we can do it in terms of pressures also. But us, we're just going to write K, call it good. All right, so here you go, little example. So for this particular reaction, what is the equilibrium expression? That's how you'd ask this question. What's the equilibrium expression? And that just means we fill in the A's, the B's, the C's, and the D's. So remember, it's products over reactants, concentration raised to the powers of their coefficients. So in the numerator on top, we're going to put phosphorus trichloride and bromine, concentration of bromine to the third power, phosphorus trichloride to the second, and then the denominator, concentration of chlorine to the third power, concentration of phosphorus tribromide to the second, just like this. Products on the top, reactants on the bottom, concentrations raised to the powers of their coefficients. Now, a few properties of these equilibrium expressions. First, if the equilibrium constant expression looks like this for this reaction here, our generic equilibrium reaction, if we reverse this reaction, put the C and the D on the left-hand side and the A and the B on the right, that's just the reverse. Well, the equilibrium constant for that is just, the products, A, now they're A and B, over the reactants C and D, which is exactly 1 over this equilibrium constant. So the prime just means it's a different number because it's 1 over the first one. So the rule is that when you reverse the way you write an equilibrium reaction, the equilibrium constant is the reciprocal of the first one. So if this is K for this one, this is 1 over K for this one here. The next rule we need to remember is that if we multiply an equation through by some number, could be an integer, could be a fraction, doesn't matter, right? Any in decimal. So if we have, again, the equilibrium expression is this for this generic equilibrium reaction. If we multiply everything through by some number n, n for number, then if you just plug in following the rules, we get another double prime, just means it's some different number. N, C, N, D, everything here is, the powers are all multiplied by N, which we could write this way, just raise the whole thing to the nth power. In other words, K double prime is equal to K to the nth power. The rule is to remember that when you multiply an equilibrium reaction by a number, all the coefficients multiplied by a number, you just raise the equilibrium expression to the power that you multiplied by. So if you multiply by n, raise it to the nth power. All right, so little example. So we say what the temperature is in these problems is that, you know, the equilibrium constant depends upon what the temperature is. So it's the same temperature, that's all we worry about. So at some temperature, 327 degrees Celsius in this one, we have equilibrium concentrations for methanol, 0.59 molar, carbon monoxide, 0.99 molar, and hydrogen, 1.1 molar. For this reaction right here, methanol decomposing into carbon monoxide and hydrogen gas. And all we want to do now is calculate the value of the equilibrium constant at this for this reaction at this temperature. So all we're going to do is write the equilibrium expression with the correct powers, plug in these values, and we'll have it. So it looks like this. So the products for carbon monoxide, its coefficient's 1. Hydrogen, its coefficient is 2. And the reactant was methanol, coefficient of 1. Plugging the numbers in, we get K is equal to 2.0.